Welcome, everyone. My name is Otília Reis. I am the Executive Director of the Fulbright Commission here in Portugal, and I'm very glad to be able to welcome you all to today's session. Just the first word that I would like to say is that the webinar, the session today, they're going to be recorded. So if you please mind that it's going to be kept on record. And thank you all for joining. If you are interested in making questions or any comments, feel free to send those via the Q&A box in the webinar, Zoom webinar platform, and they will be addressed during the Q&A portion of the session later on at the end of the presentations. And without further ado, I would pass the word to Ana Cristina Perdigão, the head of the national agency Erasmus Plus, who will be starting the presentation of the USA Portugal campus platform. Cristina, the floor is yours.
Hello, good afternoon. Thank you. It is a great pleasure to participate in this session. And most of all, it is a great pleasure to participate in this initiative, the USA Portugal Campus. As Otília said, I'm Cristina Perdigão, and I am currently the director of the National Erasmus Agency. As you probably know, the Portuguese government, specifically the Minister for Science, Technology and Higher Education, he asked the National Erasmus Agency to support the efforts of internationalization of our higher education institutions. And so when we received this challenge from FLAD and Fulbright in order to establish this new platform, it was really, really a great pleasure. And it is today our first event and also the launching of the website. So it is with the great expectations that we open our work, our platform. Besides all the initiatives you are going to hear about, and also not just the workshops, but also the forum, I would like to tell you about NAFSA, because we are already working on the Portuguese participation. And we do have already a booth with a very nice location and also a very nice size. And so in the next weeks, next few days, we will tell you more about it. And we also will want you to tell us about your intention to join us. So with no further delay, I would pass to Michael, because he's going to talk to you about the new website that is being launched today. Thank you so much for your participation and have a really nice afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Cristina. And also, can everybody hear me okay? I hope.
We can.
Okay, super. All right. Well, so let me just say that it's obviously a pleasure for all of us at FLAD, as Cristina mentioned, to work in synergy with two other really, really key partners for what is ultimately very much the mission of the Luso-American Development Foundation. This project, we've been working hard at it for some time now, it's very much part of earlier efforts that we made at the foundation, for example, with the Study in Portugal Network, to really try and put Portugal more on the map for the U.S. student and to a lesser degree the faculty members as well. And so let me just ask to move on to the next slide, because time is limited. The website is now live and you can check it out, and basically the website has been designed to be simply a tool for this community to come together. Who's the audience? The audience are a lot of you that are listening to this webinar right now, but I would say our real focus are the everyone from the rectors and vice rectors down to the folks in the the international relations offices of the various Portuguese higher ed institutions, universities, polytechnics, etc. And the goal is very much to sort of help make the American, and I use this term market, with air quotation marks, but to make the American reality more intelligible because everyone in Portugal, I think, is very, you know, well aligned and well adapted to the Erasmus student. But one thing we know for sure is that the typical American undergraduate student is very different from the typical European Erasmus student. So this website exists basically as a site for us all to come together to share resources, best practices. These webinars are all going to be archived on this website so that if you can't join us when, you know, one of the webinars goes on, you won't lose out. You'll still be able to access it. The same will be true of some of the other events that we're going to talk about in a second. And all of this is kind of culminating and leading toward more resources at your disposal to help you better prepare for the NAFSA fair and conference, which happens at the end of May, May 22. So, okay, next slide. The webinar-based training series, as I just mentioned, this is the first one, and it starts logically with an overview of the U.S. higher ed system and its many layers and specificities. The archive of today's event, you'll see, will be easily findable on the website under the archive. Okay, next slide. One thing that I want to, at the end, we'll give you a list of important dates to jot down here. But one event that we'll be organizing and taking the lead on at FLAD is happening on March 24th and 25th, a day and a half long in person. We sure hope that this is going to be an in-person conference in the auditorium at FLAD. And it will involve speakers both from the United States and Portugal and other countries in Europe. And the goal here is to touch on key issues and best practices related to internationalization, but which are not being covered necessarily by the topics in the webinars. The webinars are, we have multiple ones that are happening and they're covering a wide range of subjects, but there's still a lot more that they can't cover. And so the forum will try and press on some of those issues which are different. Okay, next one. Also, Otilia and the Fulbright Commission through the US State Department are going to be sponsoring an immersive training and study trip, I think just before NAFSA, if my memory serves, for some of the folks that will be attending NAFSA to also be able to experience a US university college campus and get some, just-in-time introduction before they arrive at NAFSA. Well, you'll hear more about that as the events come together. And then finally, the NAFSA conference. If you haven't been, it's an experience. This year it's going to be held in Denver. Usually has around 10,000, sometimes as many as 14,000 participants. It's both an academic conference, but also a major showcase fair on all that is study abroad and internationalization and higher education. And it's really, you know, the conference in North America. The dates, as you see, May 31 to June 3rd. Okay, next. So the key dates that we want you to sort of take note of, obviously this is the first of the webinar series. Then the next one is roughly a month from now, Trends and Insights Related to International Ed in the US. That's on February 4. March 11th, another Trends and Insights, in this case, you know, what's happening in the US vis-a-vis the world. And then on the 7th, institutional frameworks and support. And finally, May 6th, not quite a month from NAFSA, that should say attracting US students. That's really, you know, kind of the focus of all of these series of events. The next slide. The annual forum I just mentioned, again, March 24th and 25th, it's gonna be like a day and a half. It will be also recorded so that for folks who can't join us in person on those days, we'll still be able to access all the information that was given. And if you have any questions about that, you can contact us at that address at FLAD. And then finally, the NAFSA pavilion and fair, May 31 to June 3rd. Again, the key email there for your university or polytechnic or, you know, whatever school here in Portugal, it's really the Erasmus Mais agency that's taking the lead on receiving your requests. And then our website has more information on where the pavilion, the study and research in Portugal pavilion, is going to be located in a very, very central location. We came together this year and reserved it way ahead of time so we could get prime real estate at the fair. And it's going to have the space for, we think, about 25 schools to be able to present and have a permanent space at the Study and Research Pavilion. Okay, next. This is, again, the address of the website. It's now live, usaportugalcampus.pt. The key here is, you know, more than just having like, you know, a WhatsApp group, which is hard to navigate. The idea is to have a website where all of our resources can kind of come together and be archived and be a place where we can share information. Everything's in English because we also want it to be available and visible to partners in the US who might want to also see what we're doing. But, you know, obviously this is primarily directed at the Portuguese schools and institutions who would like to position themselves to be as open as possible to US partners compared to where they are today. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Michael, and also for keeping the time as we agreed on. Well, I'd like to start by acknowledging the presence of, in this session also of Dr. Penny Reckemer, who is the Public Affairs Officer at the US Embassy in Lisbon and the Chair of Directors of the Fulbright Commission, and several other board members are attending the session as well, so welcome. And the Fulbright program, as you probably know, wants to promote mutual understanding between Portugal and the US by providing exchange opportunities, but also providing information about the systems of education of both countries and promoting knowledge sharing initiatives. So I'm very glad to say that on behalf of the Fulbright Commission, that we are very happy to join these partners, Erasmus, MICE, and FLAD, and putting this platform together. This is part of a truly national effort to bring Portugal to make Portugal more visible in the US and attract more American students and researchers to our country. And as Michael briefly mentioned, as part of this effort, this USA-Portugal initiative, Fulbright will be organizing a series of virtual webinars. This is the first one starting today on how to broadly improve Portugal-USA collaboration and exchange in higher education. And we have also in the pipeline a training program followed by a study visit to the US, probably before now. So the dates are not set yet because also of the uncertainty that the pandemic brings to our activity. But the effort to reinforce internationalization of higher education institutions is what we are committed to develop. Today, as we start the webinar, this will provide a general overview of the US system of higher education. And I would like to start by thanking the support and the funding of the USA Study Abroad that has made these webinars possible. It's a branch of the USA, the US State Department. And to welcome you all to the first session of the webinar, I am joined by Amelia van der Laan, the USA Study Abroad Outreach Officer. As I said, the USA Study Abroad is part of the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs of the US State Department. And I would like to thank Amelia for being able to join us today. Amelia, please go ahead with your remarks.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Otilia. And good afternoon, everybody, or good morning if you're calling in from the States. Thank you so much for joining us today. On behalf of the USA Study Abroad team and the entire Department of State, welcome. We're proud to be supporting Fulbright Portugal to put on not only this multi-part webinar series for Portugal and Portuguese higher education institutions, but also just to broadly support campus internationalization in Portugal. Today's event will be doing a deep dive into the overview of US higher education, which is a big, big topic, but we're gonna try to cover a couple of areas. One, the distinctive characteristics of the US higher education system, the types of institutions, the different curricular models, but also how the university administrations work, university services, curricular aspects and degree programs, accreditation and quality assurance, as well as current issues and challenges. Now, our goal here is to support the robust internationalization of all Portuguese higher education institutes and increase the number of US students and researchers who choose to study abroad or conduct research in Portugal. And as the international education field continues to deal with the global pandemic, the State Department is absolutely dedicated to helping support international student mobility and university partnerships going both ways. This was all recently outlined in a joint statement of principles in support of international education that was issued in July, not only by the US Secretary of State, Secretary Blinken, but also our US Secretary of Education. And this emphasized the US government's support and commitment to promoting global academic engagement. And I think I can speak for all of us that we have a shared determination to build stronger university partnerships. In our globally connected world, international education is more important now than ever. And we need vibrant and creative partnerships to work across borders to address our world's most challenging, pressing issues. And so there are so many of us at the State Department, at FLAD, across Erasmus, and US and Portuguese higher education institutions who are working hard to support this next generation of diverse leaders who can help create better international exchanges for all of our students. So to support this effort, I am thrilled we're going to be joined by two incredible experts to help us as we strategically think about US education system and the foundations for how we think about partnerships, how we engage, and how we be strategic, how we can be strategic on all of this. So with that, I'll turn it in over to Otilia so we can actually dive in and get into the nitty-gritty of US higher education. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Amelia, and thank you also to the speakers, the experts that will be
I think we may have lost Otilia due to a sort of technical glitch. So it's my proud introduction to sort of introduce Ana Cristina Ribeiro Costa, who is a professor and will be our fearless moderator for sort of going through the content today. So Ana, can I turn it over to you to kick off our session such that Woody and David can kind of do a deep dive into all of our great content?
Sure. Thank you, Amelia. Hi, everyone. Good morning to our American speakers. Good afternoon to our European viewers. And I hope each one of you has a great year of 2022. It is a great honor to be moderating this panel on the overview of US higher education systems with such interesting guests. I would like to thank Fulbright for the invitation, as well as for granting me, along with the Department of State, my own SUSY scholarship on the study of the US Institutes on Youth, Workplace Development, and Closing the Skills Gaps, which also allowed me to get to know the US higher education system better. Before introducing our speakers, I would like to highlight that we have a box where you can write your Q&A, your question and answers, and I will later on direct those questions to our guests. So please use the box throughout the conference, the Q&A box for the questions, so that we can pose them to our speakers at the end of the session. Without any further ado, I will proceed with a brief presentation of our esteemed speakers. Woody Pelton served as the senior international officer at three universities from 1992 until 2021. His most recent position was as Dean of Global Education at Allen University in North Carolina, a position he held from 2009 until 2021, and when he retired, actually. Prior to these positions, he was an attorney in Washington, D.C., a volunteer for the UN Refugee Agency in a refugee camp in Malaysia, and a Peace Corps volunteer in Morocco. He received a bachelor and master's degree from University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and a JD from George Washington University. In retirement, Woody serves on the boards of the Council on International Educational Exchange, CAE, and Preservation Burlington, and as a special advisor also for strategy and partnerships for Academia Europa di Firenze. Thank you so much, Woody, for your presence here. David Mihaly has been a professional evaluator of international educational credentials since July 1987. He currently serves as an assistant director international for the American Association of Collegiate Registrars and Admissions Officers, ACRAO. He's a member of TICEP, the Association for International Credential Evaluation Professionals, has contributed to various publications published by ACRAO and NAFSA, and is a co-author of the ECE Present Series volume, The Educational System of Spain. Woody and David, we welcome you and thank you once again for your availability. And please proceed with your presentation. The screen is yours. Thank you.
All right, I have unmuted. I hope you can hear me. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you, Professor Costa, for your very kind introduction. And congratulations to everyone on the new website, which looks like it will be another great new resource for all of you. I plan to spend about 15 or 20 minutes talking about the US higher education system and then 5 or 10 minutes about the typical structure of a US university. I want to start by apologizing in advance for about 3 things. One is I will be talking really pretty quickly in order to fit in as much as I can. Also, because it's a general overview, I'll be sharing some information which you already know. I apologize for that. Finally, some of you are probably hoping that I will provide a very clear picture of what the higher education system looks like in the United States. I'm afraid you might be disappointed. There is not a clear picture. It is not clear. And so I'll just try to explain a little bit about how complicated it is and give you some ideas about how to approach it. I'll start with a very quick introduction of what students do before they enter the higher education system. So we have in the US, as you have in Portugal, a system for students to attend school basically from the age of 6 until 18. Most of those students will go through the public school system, about 90%, which is largely free. About 10% will attend a private or religiously affiliated school. While there is an expectation for all students to complete those years of school, not all do, as you can imagine. One thing I'll mention about our high school system, which might be different from what you're used to in Europe, is that our high schools basically have just one curriculum that everybody goes through. We do not divide our high school by different areas of study, as you might find, let's say, in France with the arts and the science X and the science math. We also don't divide it between those who plan to attend a university and those who do not, as you might find in the UK with the A levels and the O levels. However, there are often some advanced courses available to the stronger students that allow them to take almost college level courses while in high school. Can I ask Dorian to move to the next slide, please? Thank you. Roughly 66% of high school graduates will then continue with some form of higher education. Roughly 44% will go to a 4-year college or university and 22% to a 2-year school. We usually refer to those as community colleges. Many students will continue from community college to a 4-year system. So they will ultimately get a bachelor's degree, but spending the first 2 years with a community college and the final 2 years at a 4-year institution. There is no government involvement in placing students into higher education. There is no government test taken at the end of high school. It is a free market and a competitive system. I would say a very competitive system. You are probably familiar with the 2 privately developed standardized tests, SAT and ACT, and most universities require one of these for applicants. Although it's interesting, there is a recent movement by some of them, very competitive universities away from these standardized tests. They are admitting students just on different criteria. It's important to think of this process of entering university as competitive both for the students and for the universities. Universities have large offices designed to recruit and admit students. Some students will apply to over 10 different universities, hoping to find a perfect university and recognizing that they won't get admitted to every university they apply for. This slide also attempts to demonstrate the different pathways of post-secondary education. The numbers to the right, 1 through 7, estimate the length of time to complete one of these steps along the way, although it's important to remember they are just estimates. You'll see, for example, that they estimate 4 years to complete, complete a four-year bachelor's degree. However, the truth is the average length of completion is probably closer to 6 years. Part of that is driven by the fact that we have a lot of part-time students in the U.S., and also by the fact that very few programs in the U.S. have cohorts of students that follow a common course schedule. Also, there are many students who have more than one major or combine majors with what we call minors, so they can focus on multiple disciplines. You'll note from this chart that in the USA, professional schools such as law, medicine, and theology begin after a bachelor's degree is completed. There is a separate and very competitive application process for these students to get into a professional school. And almost exclusively, they are moving to a different school to attend law, medicine, or theology, although it's possible they could continue at the same school. There are so many different variations in the timing of the master's and doctoral tracks that I don't think it's worth spending much time talking about it. There are even some disciplines where students will go directly from a bachelor's degree into a PhD program. Next slide, please, Dorian. Thank you. As you can see, there are roughly 4,000 different colleges and universities in the United States. In comparison, in Australia, there are 37 public universities and only 2 private universities. So in the US, it's a huge, complicated picture of higher education. It's important to note that there is no central organization, no central authority. So in some ways, it is a little bit of the Wild West in higher education in the United States. It's also important to think of the different forms of governance for the universities in the United States. I'll continue to use the word primarily universities, but that will refer to universities and colleges and community colleges and other types of higher education institutions. When I speak of governance, I think it's important, as you would do in Portugal, I imagine, to separate between public universities, private universities, which could be for-profit or non-for-profit, religiously affiliated, and then other certain specialized colleges and universities, such as military universities. I will give some examples of these different kinds of universities in a moment. You will also hear or may have heard already in the United States about some particular universities. We refer to HBCUs. Those are historically Black colleges and universities. As you can imagine, those were created back in the days when education in the United States was segregated. And so there was a need to create colleges and universities for Black students. Those universities continue to exist and many of them thrive. They are not exclusively for Black students now, but the majority of the student population would be Black. We also have MSIs, minority serving institutions. Those serve minority populations. One could argue HBCUs are also MSIs, but there are MSIs to focus on other populations. We have a well-known school in Washington, D.C., Gallaudet, that serves students who are hearing impaired. We have, for example, in North Carolina, UNC, University of North Carolina, Pembroke, which is an MSI, which focuses on a population with heritage as Native Americans from the Lumbee Indian tribe. So as we think of different forms of governance, let me start talking about public universities. It's important to start by saying that when I refer to public or government supported universities, where that support comes from. It is not from Washington, D.C. They are not federally supported. They are supported by one of the 50 states that we have here in the United States. So there are 50 different systems around the country, and each system can reflect the personality and the people and the politics of that particular state. You might imagine that what happens in California is probably different than what happens in Texas because it's driven by the local state. The only universities that are directly funded by the federal government are the few military academies that we have in the USA. However, I must say that there are federal funds that are important to all universities. The federal money that comes to campuses comes as a federal research grant. These are competitive grants, but funded through federal organizations and agencies. There are student loans from the federal government that help students pay tuition. An example of that is the GI Bill, which is a program to support veterans of the services, military services, who wish to attend college and university. The federal money, by the way, is used as a way that the federal government can require universities to follow particular federal laws and guidances. Universities like to think of themselves as being very independent, but they must follow certain guidance from the federal government to get access to these federal funds. Some state governments have a university system which exists above the individual campuses. Georgia and California are two examples of that. They have university systems, and certain policies and processes take place at the system level. There are other states where the campuses are much more independent. Michigan would be an example of that. It's important to keep in mind that the mission of these state public schools is to educate students from that state. But those public schools also admit students from other states and, as you know, from outside of the country. Typically, the students from out of state will pay a higher tuition at a public school. This is important to the president and to the vice president for business and finance because it's an additional revenue stream for those students who pay a higher tuition. This can create a tension between the mission to educate citizens of the state versus the attractiveness of the higher tuition paid by those that come from outside of the state. State legislatures will typically limit the number of out-of-state students allowed to make sure that the public schools are serving the population of that state. Being a resident of a given state does not guarantee you a position at a particular university in that state or even any of the universities in that state. It is still a competitive process. Some of the major public universities that you might be familiar with are extremely competitive, even for the students from that state. The University of Michigan at Ann Arbor would be a good example of that, or California at Berkeley. So there are some very, very competitive public universities. I'll give you just an example of the various options that are available in the state where I live, North Carolina, to give you a picture. North Carolina has a population of about 10 million people. It's about 3% of the US population. But even in North Carolina, we have over 100 colleges, universities, community college options for our students. We have 16 public universities in North Carolina. We have 58 public community colleges around the state, and we have roughly 47 private universities. So even within a state like North Carolina, it is a complex picture of higher education. Private universities are even more diverse than public universities. There are some very famous ones that we all know about, Stanford, Harvard, Princeton. And then there are some very, very small colleges and universities. Here in North Carolina, we have Salem College, which was the first all-women's college founded in the United States in 1772. It is still operating, but it only has 600 students, 600 women students. Private universities can be for-profit, but the majority of them are not for-profit organizations. Many have had in the past some tie to a church. Some continue to have that tie. Others, cases that tie has disappeared over the years. Attending a private university typically is more expensive than attending a public school in your own state. Tuition at private schools, however, is typically the same for all students, whether you live in that state, come from out of state, or come from outside of the country. Another principal source of money for all universities, but particularly for private universities, are endowments based on public fundraising. We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but these endowments are extremely important for private universities and are increasingly important for public universities. For those more interested in this topic of governance, there is a link at the end of our presentation to a government website on understanding U.S. higher education, and hopefully we'll have some Q&A at the end of the session. Next slide, please, Dorian. One way to help break up the complicated range of universities in the United States is through the Carnegie classification system. Perhaps you've heard of that. This was developed in 1970 by the Carnegie Commission on Higher Education, and it is a way to classify universities based on degrees awarded and based on the level of research. And it is used, it's important as a way to break up the large number of universities so universities can be compared with like universities. That's one of the ways it is used, is a way to compare across a given classification. You can see this is starts at the top with the research one and two universities. These tend to be the larger universities. A lot of the universities you've heard of are research one and two universities. As the title would suggest, research is very important on these campuses. And then you can see yourself the different types of categories that we have here. The second one on the list, doctoral professional universities, was only created about 2 or 3 years ago. So this is not a fixed categorization, but it stays pretty steady over the years. That recent addition was new, but it doesn't happen very often. There is also a link at the end of this presentation to the Carnegie classification website where you can get more information about this. Next slide, please. Thank you. So we've talked about different forms of governance, public, private, religious, military, and we've talked about the Carnegie classifications. So when I talk to a colleague and I'm describing where I work or where I have worked, I would typically say, well, I work at a private doctoral professional university. So within the US, professionals in higher education often use this as a way to categorize different universities. If I describe to somebody both the governance and the Carnegie classification, that gives the person I'm talking with a picture in their head of the type of university where I work, I would argue that each one of these classifications has a particular personality and a particular set of characteristics. The motivations are different, dependent on the type of university. And this way of categorizing universities helps people think about the type of university we're talking about. It's also important to say that you all will see various organizations and publications that rank university on various criteria. In my opinion, there is no single ranking that is perfect. And I would suggest that a general ranking may not be the most important criteria for you to consider if you're looking for a particular partner institution or otherwise trying to think about institutions of higher education in the United States. It may be more important to look at the ranking or the status of a particular department or finding an institution that is more similar to your institution. Next slide, please. What you see up here is a random organizational chart. It happens to be of Wichita State University. There's nothing special about Wichita State University. I just wanted to give one example. I'm not really going to focus on this particular organizational chart, but I wanted to give you one to look at. The main takeaway about how the administration is laid out on campuses is once again that it varies tremendously from campus to campus around the country. There is no single structure, but I'm going to offer a few things to consider about the structure of administration on US campuses. Almost all campuses have a president, which might be referred to as a chancellor or a rector, but often president, who leads the institution. They are normally selected by a search committee with approval by the governing board. The president then reports to the governing board, which also sets the president's contract and salary. There is no fixed term limit for presidents of US universities. Their contracts might be for 3 to 5 years, or maybe the first contract is just for 1 year. The average length of service for presidents has declined over the years. And I think that just reflects that the job is becoming more difficult and more stressful. Right now, the average duration of a university president is about 6 years, but many presidents serve less than that because there are still some presidents that might serve 15 or 20 years. Much of the time of the president these days, an increasing amount of their time is spent in fundraising. I've mentioned a little bit about that, and I'll mention a little bit again later, but they will spend much time often traveling to meet with potential donors. So there is a structure of vice presidents that support the day-to-day business on all campuses. Typically, there is a chief academic officer who serves as the number two person on a campus. That person's title might be vice president for academic affairs. It might be provost. It might be executive vice president, or it might be some combination of those titles. But it is normally that person who serves as the, if it were a business, we would say chief operating officer. It is the person who directs the day-to-day business. Universities will also have a vice president for business and finance, or it might be finance and administration. So this person oversees the money aspects of the university, but also the buildings, facility planning and maintenance. Often the university police report to this person. Human resources and IT are other areas that might report to the VP for business and finance. Most universities, and especially private universities, will have a vice president for advancement or development who oversees the fundraising and efforts with the alumni from that university. Universities will have a vice president for enrollment management or admissions who has the critical task of bringing in new students each year to fill the new class. Almost all schools will have a vice president for student affairs who might be called dean of students. This person would be responsible for the well-being of students, physical and mental health, housing, clubs and organizations, and all kind of non-curricular activities on campus. Other people that might be part of the president's cabinet from one campus to another could be general counsel if the university has in-house attorney. There could be a vice president or director of communications and marketing, the director of athletics, a faculty representative who typically is the chair of a faculty senate, and increasingly there is someone on senior staff who is responsible for diversity, equity, and inclusion. Other vice presidents will vary from campus to campus depending on the nature of that campus. You will see at Wichita State University on this slide that there is a vice president in the right-hand side, vice president for, I think it's business and industry development. So that is something that is particular to that campus, and it might be on other campuses, but not all campuses. It's typical that the president's senior staff or cabinet will meet weekly. Obviously, the faculty have a large role to play on campus, and how that manifests itself will vary from campus to campus. Typically, there will be a faculty senate or association which elects a chair or president, and this person for a certain number of years or perhaps 1 year serves as the faculty representative on the senior staff or the cabinet. There can be very interesting debates on what is within the purview or jurisdiction of the faculty and what is not. Speaking of the faculty, most campuses have a tenure system, as you know, with new faculty hired as assistant professors without tenure. They go up, is the term we use, for tenure at some point, maybe 4 to 7 years after they begin. This is a big deal, and candidates prepare a very large portfolio to argue their case for tenure. If the committee approves tenure, then it would go on to the dean, and then the provost, and ultimately the president on some campuses as to whether or not that person receives tenure. If ultimately successful, they would become associate professor with tenure. If the system works well, typically a new faculty person would learn within the first couple of years whether they will be successful or not, and many will move on to another university if it appears or they're getting advice that they are not going to be successful in obtaining tenure. On most campuses, a tenured associate professor can later apply to become a full professor. This is largely based on research and publication record, but teaching and service are also important. The relative importance of research, teaching, and service varies tremendously from one campus to another. And most campuses will rely on non-tenure track faculty instructors to teach certain courses. This includes adjuncts that might teach just one course. And there could even be full-time instructors who have a permanent status, but with a reduced research expectation. I think it's generally fair to say that the administration at private universities is made easier than public universities because you do not have the extra layer of state governments and legislatures trying to control decisions and processes. I should also mention that on some campuses, staff and or faculty might be unionized, and unions then add another complication to the administration of that particular school. You'll see at the end of the presentation an article about university structure, as well as another example of an organizational chart from the University of Virginia. I want to close by just highlighting a few things that I believe are different in the United States compared to Europe, although I am no expert on higher education in Europe. One big difference, in my opinion, is the focusing on fundraising. Harvard University, which you all know, has an endowment over $53 billion, billion with a B. If Harvard were compared with countries in the world, it would be the 114th wealthiest country in the world. Obviously, most universities have much smaller endowments, but nonetheless, endowments are an important part of a president's job at universities. The status of athletics is very different in the United States compared to anywhere in the world, I would suggest. And it can have a huge influence on a campus. It can be bad news if there's a controversy, or it can be good news if a team does very, very well. With a few exceptions, students do not enter a university in a given discipline. This is different, I think, than most places in the world. So the first 2 years they spend taking general courses to determine what they would like to focus on. I thank you very much for your attention. I apologize for going so quickly. I hope we can continue a discussion during Q&A. And at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Dave, who will talk about curriculum, degrees, accreditation, and quality assurance. Thank you.
Thank you, Woody. As you can see, Woody knows a lot of things about a lot of different things, and I learned a lot just from listening to him, which I wasn't expecting to do. So I'll try to, I'm getting into the nuts and bolts details here, and I'll try to make it interesting. So if we can advance to the next slide, I'll just be talking about the US credit system and degrees and a little bit about curricula. If I can just follow up on what Woody was just saying, the first 2 years of a US baccalaureate program or bachelor's degree program is given over to what we usually call general education or the common core curriculum at any given school. And this huge amount of credit, it's roughly half of the 120 or credits, is devoted toward a general education curriculum that has, you know, as its genesis, the idea that you wanted to form very well-rounded citizens, in addition to people that had a certain subject knowledge in their majors. It's controversial. There is a lot less emphasis on some of the general education courses than there used to be. And indeed, it's possible for a US student going into his or her degree program to take not that many of those courses anymore, because some students are getting up to a year and a half of advanced standing based on the advanced placement examinations that are administered across the country. Some students are in international baccalaureate school programs in the US. So they're getting, you know, usually up to a year of advanced standing based on their scores. But in general, we're talking about, you know, half of the degree program being devoted to the general education requirement. The strength of the US system, which also leads to, you know, some weaknesses, is the incredible democratic access that students have to higher education here. There are no national examinations other than private exams like the ACT or the SAT that are required for admission. But it's possible for a student who drops out of high school without achieving a diploma at the end of secondary school to study and take what's called a general equivalency diploma examination and get a high school diploma equivalency. That student can continue on to the associate degree level, for example, and take a 2-year degree, can advance to the bachelor's level and take a, you know, another 2 years to get that degree or more. There are a lot of part-time working students in the United States system, for sure. Anyway, to the student can advance through graduate education and end up with an earned doctorate degree, starting from somebody who dropped out of school without a qualification when he or she was 16 or 17 years old. It doesn't happen all the time, but it does happen. And it's really incredible that these students often face a lot of barriers that the more traditional student might not face. But it's kind of the amazing thing about the US system. As we talk about credit systems and curriculums, it's important to realize there's a big variation in degree lengths and degree nomenclature and degree requirements. And I'll try to just gloss over those as we go. The figures we have here on this current slide are just the basic average figure. When we talk about a bachelor's degree, we're talking about 4 years. There are 5-year bachelor's degrees in architecture and other fields, and that's just part of the variation. It's really not as standardized as one would think, and yet the system manages to work. So to say that when we talk about post high school education, the first level in the United States, we refer to it as undergraduate education. In many countries, that same level might be called the graduate level. This occurred in the UK. It happens with the Graduação in Portugal. It happens in various countries where the terminology is kind of different. Now in the UK, instead of calling their postgraduate degree, at the master's level, they're now starting to call it a graduate degree and adopt the undergraduate term. So I'm afraid the US is infecting the language of some countries in education, but just be mindful that when we say undergraduate, we're talking about the first 1 through 4 years usually. And when we say graduate, we're talking about everything that comes after the baccalaureate level usually. Qualification that we can call a degree rather than a certificate or a diploma is the associate's degree. This is roughly analogous to the ciclo corto that you're familiar with. In the U.S., it's on a semester credit basis, it's 60. We can talk about credits a little bit right now, I guess. In the U.S., the standard, the two common credit systems are the semester hour of credit and the quarter hour. The semester hour represents 1 hour of classroom instruction for one semester. It's usually 15 weeks. And for each hour of instruction in class, the student is expected to take about 2 hours of their own time outside of class, for that one credit. So you may have a 3-credit course that ends up, entailing 135 hours of time for the student. Some students obviously take less and some take more. So the associate's degree, we have a 2-year degree. A lot of these are technical programs. That would be an associate of applied science program where you're an engineering technician. There are nursing programs that lead to registered nursing status in the US that are associate degree programs. Nursing is a great example of the variety. I mean, at one time in the US, you could have a high school 2-year or a 3-year hospital school or a bachelor's or a master's or a doctorate, all leading to the same status of a registered nurse. So that's just one example of the variety that exists. The community colleges and technical colleges where the associate's degree programs take place are very important to the communities and surrounding towns. They're able to concoct degree programs that address the needs of employers very quickly. At a time when there were maybe 3 or 4 mechatronic engineering bachelor degree programs in the United States, there are already probably 4 times that many at the community colleges, just because local factories needed those kind of technicians, and they couldn't wait for students to go through a whole bachelor's program to get them. So industry and the community colleges and work hand in hand very well to be responsive to the needs. Bachelor's degrees, let's just say the four-year bachelor's degree, students usually enter intake in one program. But there are plenty of students who take an associate's degree and then through agreements of transfer credit and articulation agreements are able to continue on to a four-year school. The credits vary for the bachelor's degree between 120 semester credits and 140. It's more analogous to the former system in Portugal where you had the licenciatura being a four-year program usually. Now there are some 240 ECTS or four-year licenciatura programs, and those are, you know, more analogous to the four-year bachelor's degree. However, you do have the possibility for more instruction in the major area of concentration in the Portuguese system where you're not having to take a full 2 years of kind of general education. So that's one difference. The U.S. bachelor's degree would be much more broad in terms of the coursework and perhaps not as intensive in the major field of endeavor. As Woody said, it's almost not worth talking about all the variations in the master's degree because they're legion. You can complete a master's degree in the U.S. in 1 year. Usually it was viewed as a 1.5 or 2 year endeavor, but there are master's degrees that are so-called terminal master's degrees in, say, in the performing arts, for example, where you would get a Master of Fine Arts, and that would be a 3 year terminal degree. The problem with a terminal degree is that it didn't always lead to tenure because you didn't have something called a doctorate. So a lot of those programs have now changed to offer a doctorate. Anyway, the master's degree, roughly analogous to your maestrado, that can be a degree that is more research-based, or it can be a very, very focused degree that's designed for professional advancement. Another opportunity for confusion that we'll jump into the next level, and it would have been handy to have that chart in the beginning, leave the third or fourth slide or whatever, side by side with this one. But after a student completes a master's degree, although there are provisions to go in from a bachelor's degree, the student would embark on doctoral education. The confusion here arises the fact that we have research-based doctoral programs, Doctor of Philosophy, for example. We have partly research-based programs that lead to more professionally oriented doctorates, such as the Doctor of Engineering or the Doctor of Education degree. It's probably true that the Doctor of Education arose just because a lot of students didn't want to do the foreign language requirement, which would have meant German at the time, a century ago. They developed a new, more practical program. So that's, we get a lot of different names of degrees that have the word doctor in it, and it can be confusing. There's a separate category of professional degrees, which also have the title of doctor in it, but those shouldn't be confused with the research doctorates. It's a separate classification. You have the Doctor of Medicine, the Juris Doctor for lawyers. We have Doctor of Physical Therapy degrees now, which is the first professional degree in physical therapy. A lot of these professions started out as a bachelor in law or a bachelor in medicine, and it became a doctor for the medicine people. Then it became a doctor for, the other professions, and it continues to change. A doctor of something doesn't mean that it's a research-based university doctorate, even though it's, awarded by a university after, a significant amount of study after the bachelor's degree. I think that we can advance on to the next slide, Dorian. We'll get into the issue of accreditation. as Woody said, there's no federal control of universities by a single entity such as the Ministry of Education in the United States over higher education. Because of that, the void was filled by private agencies which sought to assure quality in educational programs and formed these accreditation associations. The accreditation of an institution is important for a lot of reasons. Quality, obviously. Another important one here is that if an institution isn't accredited, that institution won't qualify for federal funding and student aid. And essentially, you're going to, you know, die on the vine if you don't have access to that money. It's important for employers to know that when they're hiring somebody with a degree in a specific field, that that person knows something up to a certain level. And that's, you know, where ensuring employer and private sector confidence comes in. Accreditation is also very important for making it easy to transfer coursework between institutions, which is very common. Students often will switch universities, you know, one, two, three times, if not more, for various reasons. A lot of people, you know, might have a family obligation that prevents them from completing. They're in a different state by the time they take up education again. And the accreditation provides for some, you know, easy articulation between the former degree program and the current program. See if we want to go on to, I think we can go on to the next slide. No, I'm sorry, we're going to go back to accreditation. So while there's no federal control, there is a Department of Education which within the federal government, and it is the Secretary of Education who's in charge of the accreditation agencies, essentially, in terms of giving guidance and providing support and, you know, doing research that, you know, supports the aims of the accreditation agencies. There are two kinds of accreditation, basically. We have institutional accreditation, which is involved with the institution. So let's use, you know, the University of Michigan, for example. That is regional accreditation from one of the six regional accreditation associations. I think maybe I had a slide out of order there. So Dorian, can you advance to the slide that has the heading accrediting bodies? Yeah, the grading scales got stuck in there. I think we'll loop back to grading if we have time, but as I'm looking at the clock, I think we're going to need to be on the accreditation bodies. So of these two types of accreditation, we have programmatic, which is, you know, relating to a specific degree program. The engineering programs have their own accreditation board, the architecture programs, the any kind of program down to, you know, parks and recreation degree programs, they all have an accreditation agency. So there are 30 institutional ones that deal with institutions. There are more than 70 programmatic ones that deal with the individual degree programs within institutions. As far as mainstream colleges and universities in the United States, we're really interested in the six regional academic accreditation associations, which have control of the different regions, institutions within the different regions. Those are the ones that, if I go to a school in my state of Wisconsin and then I transfer to a school in the state of Texas, it's going to be two different accreditation associations. And those associations and schools basically recognize each other's accreditation. Having said that, there is nothing legally binding one institution in the United States from accepting credit from another one. And you can see how that would be a problem. So people have found a way to get along through the accreditation process. And in general, if you go to a school that's accredited by one of the six regional accreditation associations, and we'll just flip through the map later on that, there's a map slide, you should be all right. Accreditation agencies set the standards with the institutions for accreditation in collaboration with those institutions that it's going to accredit. As far as the accreditation process, the school will conduct a very lengthy self-study that measures its performance and characteristics against the accreditation standards. There's an on-site evaluation of a team of peers that are selected by the accreditation agency. So these are university officials from different colleges and universities that make a team and visit the school to basically, you know, check things out. The accreditation agency, after that visit, will make its decision and publish it in the list where the accredited institutions are listed. And then there's a process of monitoring throughout the years during that accreditation period where they make sure that things are going smoothly. And then there's a reevaluation process at the end where the institution will have to, you know, apply for reaccreditation. The accreditation was interrupted by the COVID-19 outbreak in terms of as of the academic year 2020/2021, the on-site visits weren't taking place. And in response to this, the U.S. Department of Education basically granted waivers to the accreditation associations to let them have virtual visits rather than in-person visits. And it also granted waivers to institutions that didn't have the ability to deliver online programming or instruction as part of the accreditation. So if you're a school that wasn't accredited to offer, let's say, your geological engineering program online, the Department of Education gave you special dispensation to conduct those classes. And who knows where that's all going to go. As of now, there are a lot of schools that are back on campus, and there are some schools that are announcing that they're thinking of not being in person any longer. But the important thing to remember, I think, is that all these special waivers that were granted will end at some point. At such time as we can say that the global pandemic has ended, whenever that might be. The other thing I would just mention is that in response to the pandemic, there was a very serious drop in enrollment starting academic year 2020/2021. Enrollment was down about 650,000 students. However, at the same time, the amount of students enrolled in online education increased by almost 100%. It went from about 3 million students enrolled in distance education programs, either full or partially, to just short of 6 million. So that's been a drastic increase. Okay, if we can advance one slide here, I'll see if we can find out where we were. We talked about the Department of Education and these things. As far as the second major point, the overall body that oversees the six, well, not the six, but you know, the many different, almost 100 different accreditation bodies, is the Council for Higher Education Accreditation. This is based in Washington, D.C., and essentially it's a kind of a membership services organization / watchdog for the accreditors. Dorian, if we can advance one more. This is a map of the accreditation bodies. I should note that I just noticed that the Western Association of Schools, if you look on the western side of the map of the US, that's now called the Western Association of University and Community Colleges, I believe. The name has changed since this slide was prepared. But this gives you a sense of how the regions are divided. As you can see, that, you know, California is basically its own region. It's very large, and there are a lot of institutions there. Whereas the blue region in the Midwest and near Western states is quite large. That just shows you kind of the variation in the size of the territory that one association can cover versus another. And I think at this point, how are we doing on time? If we can just back up until we get to the grading slide, Dorian. I have this slide and the slide that follows it is a slide that just compares how the grading in the US might be compared with the grading in Portugal. This is from a US perspective, and it's from the ACRO Electronic Database for Global Education. I happen to work for ACRO, but I find that this scale, depending on the institutions involved, is a very conservative scale. This is just one example of how grades might be treated. As you can see, by the time we get down to the 16 or 17 out of 20 points in Portugal here, we have a US grade of B+. And I have seen plenty of transcripts where the first or second student in the class might have achieved a 17 or a 17.3 or whatever. It's obvious to a US admissions officer that such a student would be, you know, what we would call an A student. These metrics that we use are very kind of brutal in a sense, because you have to cut things off somewhere. It's just like, you know, in the US, there are institutions where a student who gets a B might have gotten an A somewhere else. You can't account for all these gradations. I realize that was kind of a harsh transition between accreditation and grading, but I just want to make sure that we leave enough time later. Okay, if we can advance one, Dorian. This is just another scale that shows how you might view US grades coming from our perspective, put it into the ECTS grade system. This is a little closer to being accurate, just because it has more ranges from the grades from 10 to 13. These are how things might be viewed from a US perspective if a student from Portugal is coming here. If a student from the US is going to Portugal, you're going to see kind of so many different grading systems, but the major one would be the letter grading scale, which is roughly analogous to the ECTS scale, except that we often have the grade of F rather than the as a failing grade, rather than the FX or G or H or the ones that aren't listed on here for the ECTS scale. That's basically how things would be converted in the US. I know that there are conventions that the universities in Portugal have for treating US grades. It's as Woody said, it's much, you know, it's much easier to look at the student as a whole and the student's activities, the kind of educational background that the student was from, than just looking at the letter grades. I'll just add, while we're on grading, there have been some studies done in the US that suggest that online learning during the pandemic has resulted in a slight decrease in student performance. There was a good kind of controlled study done at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. This would be the Army Academy, essentially, where they calculated a 0.2 point drop in student performance during the online education. Interestingly enough, in most of the studies, it suggests that male students do poorer in an online environment, and also students that had less academic preparation, maybe from a high school that didn't have the academic resources that some of the other ones do. So that's just a kind of a current comment on grading, and we'll see a lot of studies on that in the future. I think that will conclude my remarks for now, and I'll turn it back over to Anna so we can finish up the program. Thanks for your attention. I'm really amazed that you are all following me in a language that might not be your native language. I would not be understanding a presentation that was delivered to me in Portuguese. So I thank you and I commend you for that.
Thank you so much, Dave, and Woody, for both your clarifying presentations. I will now address some of the previous questions that the participants posed, as well as the ones that were in the meanwhile posed at the Q&A. I would like to clarify that some of the previously posed questions were already addressed during the presentations. And I also suggest our participants to take a look at the next session's themes, as other questions may be answered in further sessions. In any case, our speakers will give their emails, here they are, their emails for specific answers. So I suggest if you have a very specific question on a certain area of expertise, I suggest that you directly email them afterwards for more specific questions. In any case, for more general ones, please use our Q&A chat here at the Zoom. Well, among the questions that were previously posed and the ones that we have now, I selected among the many we have received from the participants, I have selected a few of them, and I would like to pose some of them to Woody and some of them to Dave. And of course, if you believe that you can contribute or comment on each other's questions, please feel free to do it, of course. My questions or the participants' questions to Woody, as they weren't directed to one or another, I just did that because of the presentations that you both gave us. But the questions to Woody would be, for instance, Francisco Souza asked whether he's right in thinking that all the Ivy League universities are private. That was the one of the questions that was posed. And two other questions I would like you to address, Woody, if that's possible, would be, how does master and doctoral research supervision work? And how do US different curricular models influence work-life balance, well-being of workers, and the future of work? That last question interests me a lot. That's my area of research, to the future of work and employment. And the questions I would like to pose, Dave, I can repeat them afterwards if you need to. Dave, what may students from the US expect from a Portuguese university? Why would people from the US would want to come to Portugal to study? These are different questions, but actually they come out the same way. What language skills are usually required? I assume that the question would be at US universities, but maybe this has to do, of course, with these students coming to Portugal. And how are institutions dealing with e-learning? You talked a little bit about it, and we would like to know some more information on that. Please feel free to answer each other's questions if you believe that would be better. And thank you so much for your availability to be here and to spend some time with us, letting us know so much about the US education system. Woody, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Anna. I'll try to do the three in order, and then I might tackle one of the ones that was directed to Dave. So the question about the Ivy League schools, all of them are private and Research One institutions. The one that is a little bit deceiving is the University of Pennsylvania, which sounds like it's a public institution, but it is not. It's a private institution. So you're correct, all of them are private. The second question had to do with supervision at the master's and doctoral programs. I have to start by saying that this is not an area that I have a tremendous amount of expertise in. But as I understand it, and there are probably others on the call that know more than me, and I would invite them to chime in, that part of a faculty person's load or requirements would be supervision of a certain number of master's degree students or PhD students. So it's considered part of their job, if you will. So there are faculty at Research One institutions who do very little teaching, maybe no teaching at the undergraduate level, and their responsibilities really center around their own research and the supervision of the research of their graduate students. And it can be, that's a sliding scale, if you will. So maybe you're teaching one course, or maybe you're teaching two courses, or maybe you're teaching no courses at the undergraduate level while you focus on research and graduate students. But I'd encourage others to weigh in on that, because it's an area that I don't pretend to be an expert on. The last question about work-life balance, wow, that's complicated, isn't it? I don't think there's an easy answer to that. And so, but it is a topic of conversation, I must say, on the campuses that I have been on. I'm not sure it's tied to the curriculum. I think it's just tied to the culture of the campuses, to the financial constraints of campuses, where if they are lacking resources, they are asking people to do more work because they have difficulty hiring more people. So it's a very current topic, a very good question. But I don't think I have a very good answer for you on that one. But it's a topic on the minds of many people at universities. The one out of David's list that I thought I might take a shot at, because I've been involved in the study abroad part of US campuses a lot, the question about why would a student choose to go to Portugal? So another good question. In my opinion, and I've been at a school that sent a tremendous number of students abroad, about 1,500 a year. And I think those students, I would divide into two groups. Those students who are looking for the safest or easiest or lowest hurdle as far as studying abroad. And as you can imagine, a lot of them go to the UK, Italy, Spain, Australia, places like that. But then there's also the category of students who are looking to go to a different place, to some place that's not as typical, because they want to escape the other American students. And so I think the pocket of students that Portugal needs to figure out how to attract are those students who want to be outside of the most common destinations. And the bonus, I would say, for all of you in Portugal is, in my opinion, those are the best students, because they don't want to go where their friends are going. They want to go someplace where they think they can really learn about the culture and the community and immerse themselves. So the numbers will never be like they are in Spain, but I think you will get some really good students who will be, could easily be attracted to Portugal. The second thing I'll say about it, I'm almost embarrassed to say, but I will say it anyway. One of the advantages of Portugal is that you are close to the rest of Europe. And so there will be students who will come to study in Portugal, but you will see them leave many weekends on Ryanair to go to Prague or Barcelona or someplace. So so I think that is an advantage of Portugal, to be honest.
Thank you, Woody. I wouldn't say that's something to be embarrassed of. I believe that's quite an interesting aspect that we have, and quite an interesting experience for international students to enjoy. And that should be enhanced and nothing to be embarrassed about. We have other questions, but I'll first give the floor to David for him to answer his part of the questions, and then I'll come back to the other ones. Thank you, Dave.
Sure. I would just say in regard to the last topic, the way I understand the question is, you know, what would US students be expecting to find in Portugal? And here we have to be careful not to, you know, have a monolithic idea of the American student. The American student for the last 100 years has been regarded by U.S. education professionals and people abroad as, you know, so, kind of not the most rigorous person. Of course, you know, it runs the range of the gamut of kinds of people. But if I could just say anecdotally, there are many U.S. students who are looking to get the authentic experience. A lot of them prefer to live with a family rather than in a dorm or in an apartment by themselves. Those people get immersed into the culture in a much more fundamental way than the students who might be, you know, in a campus housing situation or in a block of student apartments. Just anecdotally, you know, my own daughter's first study abroad experience was in Moldova, which is not a common destination for students from the US. She slept on a chair that was held together by hook and loop closures and came apart into a kind of a flat mattress, lived in the only common room in a three-room apartment. That was her experience. And, you know, she's connected to that family to this day. And, the next year she spent abroad was in Kazakhstan. It's not something you can do to just, you know, pinhole these students. And I agree with Woody completely. If there is, and I'm not an expert in this area, but if there is a way to target and attract that kind of student through some kind of a campaign, for lack of a better word, those are the students that, you know, we want to come back here with mm-hmm. that knowledge and you probably want to have there. I think the next question dealt with the language skills, and I'm not sure if that was the language skills required for study abroad in the United States from a Portuguese student's perspective, but there are indeed what we would call remedial courses in English as a foreign language, English as a second language. You know, two different fields, but they're very related for foreign students as they're taking their coursework. So that a student that can't demonstrate language proficiency can still study abroad on various programs in the United States and be direct enrolled with U.S. students at the same time that they're learning English. I tutored a Japanese student when I was taking English as a second language classes, you know, 40 years ago. Those students are able to survive, you know, based on the fact that they might read at a certain level, but just not understand spoken English as well. And so there are resources in the United States. I think that must have been the way that question, but if it was going the other way, I don't have much of an answer. There certainly isn't a lot of Portuguese language being taught at the high school or the junior high school level in the United States. And in fact, foreign language isn't even required in every state's high school curriculum. It's becoming much less common that you would have a state that doesn't have a requirement like that, but it used to be very common. That's another thing that US students are looking for, is just to be forced to learn another foreign language, for lack of a better word. It's an excellent way to do it. As far as e-learning, my knowledge of this is rather anecdotal as well. Universities were all forced to go online in a hurry. And the people that were already doing online education at universities and colleges in the United States did a huge amount of heavy lifting, trying to help the other departments get up to speed. And it's the development in very little time of platforms that could actually handle the overload. I know, Zoom and every the other platforms had a problem and just dealing with, There are a lot of students who are visually impaired or have difficulty hearing. They had to figure out a way to serve all those students, and other than to say that it's very much a work in progress, and that I think we don't know what portion of online education will exist after we get to the other side of the current situation with regard to the pandemic. I suspect that online learning, which had been growing in the United States anyway, and in other parts of the world, is going to occupy a much higher percentage of the student experience than it did before. Other than that, I don't really have a lot of to say.
Thank you so much, David. To wrap up, I would like to address you some final questions that have been posed. For David, Mariana Abrantes asks us whether you can describe the current process of choosing a major discipline right now. Is it the student's option sometime during sophomore year two, or do departments select their students? And if so, in what on what terms? And for Woody, Woody, does Elon University have any partner in Portugal? And if not, is there a particular reason? There was another question that you answered here in Britain, but maybe I will read it anyway, because I don't know whether the other participants have access to it. I believe they do, but it's quite interesting. It's about how 80% of US higher education students are also workers, and how that affects their ability to study abroad. And you answered something very interesting, that is many can get away for they would like to get away for smaller periods to get foreign programs, and that could be something quite interesting to do. But if you could address these two questions, we can invert this way and start by David and then wrap it up with Woody, if you wouldn't mind.
Sure. The process of selecting the major depends on the student almost entirely, except that there are various schools or departments within a university that have certain grade average requirements for a student to finally enroll in that major and undertake that major or course of study. This is true certainly for engineering and for education, for example, for accounting, other so-called first professional programs in the undergraduate experience. They would have a restriction on who can study based on the first year and a half, 2 years, which are frankly designed to weed out a lot of students, because not everybody who wants to study accounting, for example, will be allowed to study accounting. But you are allowed to embark on that path without any restriction at the start of your university career. So it's up to the student. Many students change a major just because they've been exposed to something that opened their eyes to another way of seeing things or a field that fascinates them. And these stories are very common. In fact, it's not uncommon for a student who gets a bachelor's degree to work for a while and go back and pursue another degree entirely. But in terms of the first 2 years of university education, that's really your time limit to decide on a major. Some students know right away what they're going to study. Others, take their time and they switch. And that's why, you see people taking 5, 6 and even more years to complete a bachelor's degree program just because they were on several different tracks. But there's no tracking such as another country where, you will be a railroad engineer per the dictate of the state. That doesn't happen. There are, of course, suggestions as to fields that students might go into that they don't go into. There's no prohibition on embarking in a certain major until you actually demonstrate that you didn't achieve academically to the level that particular faculty demands within the university.
All right, and so I'll step in. One thing I'll add about the majors and selecting a major in the first couple of years, in addition to what Dave said about some restricted majors, it's also fair to say that the faculty in various departments are trying to actively recruit students into their discipline. So a history professor might talk to a student and say, you really should be a history major because that it's a discipline they like and that they're trying to attract good students. The question about, does Elon have a partner in Portugal? I should start by saying I am retired from Elon, so I'm no longer a representative of Elon University. But I think the answer is no. And I would invite whoever's interested in that to send me an email at the email that you see on the screen. And I'm happy to follow up on that conversation, but ultimately I would be doing so as an outsider from Elon, but I know who the insiders are and I'm happy to direct you to those people. And Anna, can you remind me, there's another question?
The other one was the one you answered in written about the 80% of students that are working at the same time.
That's right, and thank you for that question. I think the person who posed the question said this is a very distinctive of the US education system, and I would agree. I think that is true. I think it's part of the culture of the US that, we all believe in working, it's a working society. And so parents think that their children should work while they are at school. Many parents think that. But I should say that sometimes that's as little as 5 hours a week or something like that. And it might be often a job on campus. So another part of the culture on US campuses is that the offices hire a lot of students. I don't think that's true necessarily at all universities around the world. So the office that I worked in, for example, we had about 16 full-time employees, but we probably had 20 students who worked for us 5 hours a week, 10 hours a week, some as much. The maximum would be 20 hours a week. And so that adds additional experience to the students. They appreciate it. They put it on their resumes to indicate that they were working while they were in school. So a second question, follow-up question was, will that prohibit them from studying abroad? Typically, the answer is no, because if it's an on-campus job, whoever hires that student on campus recognizes that possibility and doesn't want to prevent that student from studying abroad. So they would release them, if you will, and the student could spend time abroad. The other thing I put in my answer is that the trends of US study abroad are moving in the direction of shorter programs. So compared to 10 years ago, there are many more students going for a short-term program, 3 weeks or 4 weeks in the summer. So almost anybody can get away for 3 or 4 weeks in the summer. So I don't think it creates a complete obstacle to study abroad, but it is part of the culture of US campuses.
Thank you so much, Woody. I would like to inform you that the recording of this session will be available on the USA Portugal campus website, the one that was launched today, so you can accede and have access to it later on. I thank our speakers once again for their interesting presentations. I hope to meet you in person in the future. Mm-hmm. And I give the floor or the screen to Otilia Reis for the closing remarks. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Anna. And of course, I would like to thank our excellent speakers for their excellent presentations. I recall that the webinar will be is being recorded and will be available at both the USA Portugal campus new website, as well as at our YouTube page at the Fulbright Commission webpage. A special thank is due also to Ana Ribeiro Costa. I was about to introduce you when my internet connection fell, but thank you for a job well done. You are an assistant professor as well as a lawyer, and it shows that the efficiency, how efficiently you run the webinar moderation. And you are also an alumna of the study of the US Institutes program, which is a State Department program for scholars coming to the US from abroad. In Portugal, it is administrated by the Fulbright Commission and the US Embassy. And I'm so happy that you were able to complete it, even if online last year in 2021, precisely on workforce development and the future of work. So thank you so much for collaborating with us. I would like to thank you all for staying with us for this session. Please check the next webinar calendars and the next activities. And I wish you all a nice weekend, and thank you for your participation. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Otilia. Bye-bye. Thank you. Have a nice weekend.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.